Tonight on Dateline, one of the world's most peaceful countries preparing for the worst.
So these are all canned goods. They have like a quarter of a ton of rice, 42 kilos of ravioli.
What are they prepping for?
Terrorist attack, school shooting, war.
Really?
Yeah, like Russia.
Russia?
Come in here and shoot us.
And could their fears be more real than we think?
You can't depend on the government to bring you food or get you water. You have to do it yourself.
This water is very clear and you can drink it.
It's the old Cold War all over again.
In Sweden, they say only dead fish follow the stream. It's a warning against mindlessly copying others. And one small reason why in the quiet town of Vakwa, this house looks a little different.
Jo, jag skulle säga, kom ni ihåg när vi hade den här brandövningen? Mm. Kommer du ihåg var brandsläckarna finns?
Nej, men det är väl i festugan sen, här i trappan.
48-year-old Lotta Delanius is a nurse and single mum who wants her family to be prepared.
Och sen måste ni, det var det första man ni måste göra.
Vadå?
Rädda, larma, släcka. Kolla så att ingen är inne i huset. Ska ni få ut katten också kanske?
Ja, men det är förut av sist.
She's part of a growing movement of Swedes who call themselves preppers.
I've been prepping for about 4 years. A prepper is one who takes care of themselves and makes sure that we can survive if some crisis comes. You need light. You need to prepare your meals.
Lotta isn't just preparing for blackouts or storms.
You got a knife, scissors.
She's also preparing for armed conflict. And her readiness is supported by the government.
And we also have this, of course, which contains all the vital information that you need to know.
What does it say on the front there, Lotta?
It says, if the crisis or war is coming. Really, because it's what it's about. It tells you what you need to prepare, how much food you need to have at home, why do you have to be a prepper, essentially. This came last year, I think, to everyone, every household in Sweden. Really good.
Preppers are often viewed as God-fearing outliers, predicting the end of the world. But in this Nordic nation, a neighbouring threat is helping the movement go mainstream.
I can see that the Russian threat has increased the last few years. Just look at Ukraine, which is a European country who has been invaded. There's a game going on, who's going to threat who. So yeah, we have to be on the lookout and be prepared.
Och nu ska vi prata om spioneri, för igår så meddelade Säpo att Ryssland är det land som fortfarande spionerar allra mest på Sverige.
Swedes have been bombarded by news about Moscow since Russia occupied eastern Ukraine in 2014.
På internationellt vatten, 6 mil söder om Karlskrona, ska den ryska marinen hålla robotskjutningar nästa vecka.
From suspicious submarines.
Barn och ungdomar som var på seglarläger i närheten filmade de här sekvenserna. Experter som TV4-nyheterna har pratat med bedömer att det som syns på bilderna sannolikt är en ubåt.
To planes in its airspace.
Jaktflygplanet ut från Kaliningrad och kommer i hög fart och passerar oss ganska långt bort, men ändå närmare än vad som är brukligt. Svänger runt och passerar oss ännu en gång då i vad vi bedömer som överljudsfart.
Russian military activity has Sweden spooked.
Vitvalar är populära turistattraktioner, men kan de också vara tränade spioner? Experter spekulerar nu kring att valen kan ha tränats av den ryska flottan.
But it's more than just a perceived threat. Sweden's own defense research agency has made a shocking announcement.
So Johan, you recently published a report looking at Russia's military activity. What did it find?
My conclusion was that Russia is preparing its armed forces for a large-scale war. And in the Russian context, that pertains basically to war over a continent.
And so how is that different to, say, their activities over the last 5 or 10 years?
Russia has used its armed forces more selectively. In Donbass, eastern Ukraine, and Crimea, Georgia and Syria. But these exercises tell a different story. It's the whole military machinery.
And so, Johan, you can really see just how close Russia is to Sweden when you look at this map.
This distance, I think, is about some 300 kilometers across the Baltic Sea. This is actually Kaliningrad, a Russian exclave. The main part of Russia's Baltic fleet for the Baltic Sea is in here.
Reading through hundreds of Kremlin press statements, Johan Norberg has noticed a frightening build-up of Russian military exercises involving troops, tanks and aircrafts on its home turf.
I can see that the number of forces actually participating is picking up. Just imagine 300,000 soldiers, all levels, all branches of services, doing things at the same time for the same purpose. Just to get it all to work is a major challenge.
How serious then is the threat of Russia to Sweden's homeland defense and security?
A threat usually entails an intention and a capability. I don't study Russia's political intentions, so what they want to do, I don't know. But I can see the capabilities they build. That is worrying, because they build the capabilities, we don't know exactly when and how and against whom they're going to use it.
This feeling that Sweden is increasingly vulnerable is why many preppers are learning old skills to survive. 6 hours north of her home in Växjö, in the middle of the Swedish wilderness, Lotta is bugging out.
So here is our bug out location. It's a place where you can go if shit hits the fan and is completely off grid. So this is our second location, and we have a third location as well.
Here, Lotta is testing her ability to stay alive.
So I have just an old broomstick.
Really?
Yep. Cut it off, drill a hole, put a spike and some string, and there you go. So you put around your neck, and if you fall into the water, you can just pull yourself up.
Mm. Why is it so important to know how to improvise as a prepper?
You have to be able to make sure you're safe. And if you can't go to the store to buy stuff, you have to make it yourself.
Getting back to basics is a key part of prepping. To survive out here, Lotta lives by a simple motto: improvise, adapt, overcome.
A lot of skills has gone lost in the recent years. When I grew up, we were always like in the woods, fishing and stuff. Kids nowadays, they stay indoors and they play their online games, and maybe those skills is obsolete when there is no electricity or internet.
She's almost completely self-sufficient, with water from the stream and fish from a frozen lake.
We have to go on the ice where the sun hasn't shined all day. So we'll try to go out here, I think.
I think I'm gonna hang back for a moment here.
It's pretty thick.
Lotta's learning to problem solve because she knows living through a disaster is a completely unscripted experience.
You make prepping look a lot like fun, Lotta, but it actually is quite serious, isn't it?
Yeah, of course it's a more serious side to it. There is a possibility of an armed conflict in our area of the world. And the prepping that I do is to make sure that my kids have the things they need if I'm not there to take care of them.
If war was to come, do you trust your government to provide and look after you?
I think they will do what they can, but right now we don't have enough facilities, knowledge or the organization to do that. So right now, no, you have to prep yourself and have all the things that you need. Nothing today.
I'm told one reason preppers feel vulnerable is because an old military strategy, once pioneered by Sweden, today lies in tatters. Known as total defence, it ensured being prepared was part of the national psyche. You wouldn't know it from the outside, but beneath this street is a giant bomb shelter.
Big entrance. And welcome to the Marievaret shelter. The place has been standing a long time without ventilation, so the air is not as good as it should be.
Yeah, you can really smell the mold down here.
Yes.
Built in the 1950s, these bunkers are relics of the Cold War, when the entire country was prepared for an attack. Enough of them were built to protect the entire Swedish population at the time, around 8 million Swedes.
And how many people is it meant to shelter then?
For the moment, 3,400
people. 3,400 people,
yes,
can fit inside this bunker.
Yes, that's correct.
Här finns hobbylokaler, inte bara för sömnad utan även för fotografering, för måleri och skulptur.
Once state of the art, the government even spruced this bunker in films at the time.
Här finns en förstklassig teaterscen för amatörer.
As a place to live, watch movies, even exercise.
Flickskolan på Mariabergets topp har fått den här vackra gymnastiksalen, förmodligen enastående i världen.
But in the early 2000s, Sweden slashed defence spending. And like much of total defence, these bunkers fell into disrepair.
2010 var Sverige mycket nära en stor katastrof.
Now Sweden's government is bringing total defence back for the first time in more than half a century.
Om ett stort kraftverk hade stoppat, hade detta gett omfattande konsekvenser över hela landet.
Christina Anderson is from a civil emergency agency whose entire job is preparing society for crisis.
Hej, hörni.
Hej.
Hur går det?
Det går bra.
Vad söker du information vid en kris? Fixar ni den eller hur? Var kom ni fram till?
Kommunens hemsida.
We are putting several different questions about what can happen, how can it affect your daily life, and how can you prepare to handle a crisis as good as possible.
Today, she's teaching a generation who've only ever known peace to imagine war.
Vid ett längre elavbrott kan det vara så att man inte kommer in på någon webbsida.
Fast hur kunde man då komma in på Tinder för den där
reklamen? We are putting more effort into our total defense. That means to the whole society to be prepared to handle heightened alert or the threat of war from governmental agencies to local municipalities, but also individuals.
And you actually wrote the booklet that was distributed.
Yeah, well, we distributed this to 4.8 million households in Sweden last year.
This booklet is a pretty scary thing to receive in the mail. Were people afraid when they received it?
Yes, but at the same time, I think that this is important social information that each people living in Sweden need to have.
Yeah. Okay.
And so what have you listed here as your main concerns?
Terrorist attack, school shooting, war, and natural disasters.
War?
Mm. Yes.
Really?
Yeah, like Russia.
Russia?
Come in here and shoot us. I don't trust them. Putin and all his members. I don't know.
The government is hoping this new generation won't just prep, but act.
Yeah.
Jag tar befälet! God morgon, kronovärjare!
500 kilometers south of Stockholm, I've been invited to see military training for Sweden's Home Guard. Like Australia's reserves, it's made up entirely of civilian volunteers. Among them is Lotta.
Well, this is one of the yearly exercises for the Home Guard that we do at least twice a year. So we're going to sharpen our will and strength to defend the country.
The Home Guard is half of Sweden's entire defence force, so it relies heavily on these civilians.
Det är kort avstånd, ett jävligt viktigt vapen. Och därför är det jäkligt viktigt att det fungerar. Frågan är om man kanske inte ska lägga den extra resursen för att ha en laddare till sin kulspruteskytt.
Overseeing their training is Lieutenant Colonel Per Erik, who's witnessed the military diminish over the past 30 years.
The armed forces was quite huge, and then we have been reducing all times from 700,000 to be now 50,000 people in the armed forces, including the Home Guard. It's not enough if something should happen to Sweden. The big picture mission is to have them ready if something should happen, well trained and filled up, you know, to 100%.
While some volunteers train in military combat, Lotta, a trained nurse, tests others in emergency first aid.
We have been naive. People thought that, nothing's gonna happen to us, we're safe. And then we lost all that knowledge.
Det var jag som gav det där i åren att du åker ner till staben, informerar staben att vi behöver en ambulans.
För det blev ingen riktigt bra miss där. Vad var det som hade hänt?
There's clearly still a lot to learn, but today is just a simulation.
Så det är viktigt att veta vad ingår i min roll liksom. Så. Men vi hittar våra punkter där vi behöver öva mera. Superbra. Okay, nu kommer
Before I leave, I ask the lieutenant colonel if he thinks they're prepared.
If war did come tomorrow, how do you think you would go?
Well, tomorrow we are not so many. We do try to do our best, but also to get other countries to come and help us, that's for sure. We are very vulnerable, and so that's something been discussed quite a lot in Sweden the last years.
While the Lieutenant Colonel says they would call on neighbouring countries for help, Sweden still isn't part of any formal alliances. But back in Stockholm, this isn't something the country's defence minister is concerned about.
Would you like to see Sweden sign NATO?
We are a non-allied nation and we will be a non-allied nation. And I think that is the best for the stability in our part of Europe.
How serious a threat then is Russia to Sweden's security?
I think the realities are very clear. You have this aggression to Georgia 2008, you have this annexation of Crimea against international law and regulations, you have this war going on in Ukraine, you have a Russian leadership that are ready to use military power to fulfill political goals.
Are you concerned?
I see it as necessary to invest and have a new strategy for the defense forces in Sweden, to invest in upgrading our national capability and deepening the cooperation with others. And the most strategical decision we have taken is to reactivate conscription service in Sweden, and we have that since 1st of January 2018.
Mm. What do you say then to citizens who are concerned that you aren't doing enough?
You build military capability step by step. It takes a long time. We invest now a huge amount of money in military investments. So I feel when I meet people that we have a real support for the governmental position and what we are doing today.
Sweden's military spending is actually at a historic low. It's only 1% of GDP, which is less than NATO recommends. So government moves to revive total defence, a cold comfort for many preppers. Back in the north, I'm meeting one prepper who's taking radical steps to move permanently off-grid.
Hi, Andreas.
Hi. Welcome.
Nice to meet you.
You too.
Oh, I feel like I'm entering Narnia right now.
Well, you are one of seven people who knows this place.
Really?
Yeah.
I feel very privileged. I understand that preppers keep their bug outs pretty anonymous.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Well, mostly because you don't want unwanted visitors during a crisis.
I did some extensive research before I bought this place, looking at population density and what roads led to this place and did not lead to this place. So it's off the beaten track, so to speak. I also did check up on military targets around the areas I was looking for, to be safe from, well, bombs and such.
Well, this is part of my food storage. So these are all canned goods and some dry stuff.
Bullen special sausage, which is a huge divider in the prepper community of Sweden, depending on if you like it or hate it. Most people hate it, I suppose. But I don't.
I tend to only prep things that I like to eat. It's useless to prep things that you don't like. I mean, what's the point of eating food you don't like when things are going to hell in a handbasket?
Unlike Lotta, Andreas has been prepping for more than a decade. Prompted by the 2008 financial crisis, he now has enough food hidden around this cabin to help him survive out here for 2 years.
Even though we see signs that things are taking a turn for the worse, we don't act, we just talk. And I can't trust the government to take care of me as it stands of now.
Well, I got everything on this list, actually, that I have in my storage. So for starters, I have like a quarter of a ton of rice. That's around 900,000 calories, 40 kilos of sugar. I have 42 kilos of ravioli. Ideally, I would like to have the double amount of foodstuffs that I have now. So let's say 4 years. Then I would feel a bit more on the safe side. Mm-hmm. So I have a bit more work to do.
What's on the menu for tonight, Andreas?
Well, it's pea soup and hard bread. Yeah, I know it looks a bit gross, but it will be fine when it's done, I promise.
An extraordinary amount of thought has gone into every inch of this cabin. It's a remarkable achievement in self-sufficiency.
Wow. How long can this last for, Andreas?
5-6 years, perhaps.
But Andreas knows not everyone sees it that way yet.
Right now we are in a state of flux or a change in Sweden. Though most people that are not prepared, well, they have a journey to make, so to speak.
So what would you say then to people who still think prepping is a little bit crazy?
I encourage people to look at the real world around them, because Sweden is not a bubble isolated in the world. Look at what happened in Sarajevo and the former Republic of Yugoslavia. Look at what happened in Syria. Look at all the civil wars that you have throughout history. Look at Venezuela, Brazil, Argentina. I mean, I could just keep on going. So things can happen, and they can happen here as well. So learn from history.
Should people be scared?
No, definitely not. Never be scared. That's counterproductive.
Just eat pea soup.
Eat pea soup and be happy.
Staring down the worst case scenario, perhaps there's a certain courage to what Andreas and Lotta do. Far from crazy, it's even a little admirable.
What if war and the worst thing never happens?
That's great if it doesn't happen. At least I will know that I had the ability to support myself and my loved ones. And knowing that, that's a great feeling.
Will you be disappointed?
No. The other way around, I will be very happy. Isn't that what we all want? To live in peace.